United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, you all have better access to do that right here. How should we conduct this? Do you want to just start in by telling what our situation is? How do you want to start the meeting?
Yeah, you can take it in as well.
Well, explain to everyone your situation in the 911, will you?
Well, this started back the other day.
Okay, wait. One thing that's really bad out here is sound. So speak up. I don't know if you can hear me in the back. Can you hear me? Okay. Try to broadcast a little louder.
Okay. This whole mess started in the middle, or about the middle of June, when I started losing full-time staff. I lost one full-timer in June, and I just lost two more at the beginning of July. I've lost two part-time staff, and that leaves me with five full-time and four part-time. And I'm going to get ready to lose three more full-time staff, which will put me down to two full-time dispatchers, myself working the radio again, and one trainee. I posted the job openings on Indeed. I've had 89 resumes that I personally have called each and every single person and emailed them a copy of our application. I've received 17 applications. I've done interviews on each one of those people. And out of all of those 17 applications, I've had one that I'm able to hire. And I had to push her start date back because I have nobody to train. I have one in training right now. One of my staff members is refusing to train on the night shift. And I'm not sure where this leaves us, but I'm in a staffing crisis. I don't have enough people to run this center. I have been picking up shifts on my days that I'm there. I'm there currently trying to do my administration side, trying to fix this center as the mess that I picked up on when I took over in December. And it's just not working. I don't have the staffing to be able to work the radio and do my administrative duties that I was hired to do as the 911 director here. I will have worked 130 hours in this bay trying to get this mess resolved. I don't know where we go from here. I have contacted White County and sit down with their director just to have a conversation about what if we were to farm out calls for 12 hours. When we worked with Indigital, who works with our 911 stuff, we've laid out calls for our busiest hours, which is from 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. So I thought if we could farm out calls and actually work the shift from 12 p.m. to 12 a.m., as actually having our dispatch center dispatched on the day shift, and then farm it out on the night shift from 12 a.m. to 12 p.m. She unofficially was in agreement with this, and we discussed cost. And she was going to have to meet with her commissioners and the county attorney also to discuss whether they were even willing to take this. I didn't hear back from her until this morning, and they are not willing to help us out at all with any of it due to the liability issues of officer safety and the safety and security of everyone here. There's so much reconfiguration we have to do with the center to actually ship it up to them. I'm not even sure it would even be possible. And I have made phone calls to all the other surrounding dispatch centers, Clinton County, Tippecanoe, and Cass. I have not physically talked to their directors because no one will call me back. I don't know where to go from here. I don't know what to do. I'm at a loss. That's why I asked for the emergency session of my advisory board. The only thing we can figure out is we are going to have to boost the part-time and full-time staff pay to get quality people in here. Because in this profession, in every profession, competence comes with some compensation. And I'm not saying that they're underpaid here, but when you can go to a surrounding county and make $5 more an hour at doing the same job, I don't know if I blame you for leaving. And that is the reason they're leaving. that and the accountability that they haven't had in the last 10 years at this center. I have been holding people accountable for their actions and for other things in the center. By no means am I ruling them with an iron fist, but they need some accountability for the stuff that's going on here. The toxic attitudes, the not doing their job, the refusal to do the job. I don't even know what else to do with this. And that's why I'm glad you guys called this meeting, and I appreciate it, so we can discuss what the next move is for the center. I don't think getting rid of the center is even questionable here. Ever. This county needs a 911 center. And it will be sad if there's nobody in the seat to take that 911 call.
Jail is always teetering on where they're at now of being able to keep anybody. So we're going to have to hire three or four more if we were to run it down, just to be able to cover shifts during that 12 hours. The pay needs to be bumped up, at least for part-time, to a rate that's going to encourage White County full-time dispatchers, Tippecanoe County dispatchers, to come in here, be able to train our dispatcher still, because he's got to get back to his staffing levels that he needs, but he needs to train. So it's, if we're able to raise the pay, it's got to be something that can get these qualified people that can't need to be trained. The problem is now. We can't wait. I think he said 24 weeks. If you walk in, Scott, if you walked in to be a dispatcher, it's going to take 24 weeks until you're ready to be released on your own. So we need to make it so people want to come here and help us for I'm not talking permanent raise of a huge salary, but something to get people in here while we shore up our own dispatch.
So for training purposes, so if somebody hires them and then they go away for training, or do you do the training?
We do the training here.
And then who trains right now?
I have one trainer.
So
one of my dispatchers.
One of the other dispatchers.
All new dispatchers are required by the state to sit through a 40-hour class for just baseline knowledge before they're ever put behind the console. There's certain certifications they have to hold before they sit there, and then their 24 weeks start the first day they're behind the console. That's pretty much state standard as far as any dispatcher you go to. It's anywhere from 20 to 24 weeks worth of training.
And we have one, is what he's saying. We have one trainer, and we have another trainer that is refusing to train.
But then you're saying that they possibly would come from Tiffany and White County, but after talking to both of them, they're kind of in the same boat. They don't have enough employees also, so I kind of see that being hard.
When I talk to, not to interrupt you, when I talk to Terry, her and I have the conversation about them, her asking her staff, she did post a memo in her dispatch center asking if anyone was willing to come down on their days off and work for me. As far as we need seasoned dispatchers in here, that all I have to do is train them. They already know how to dispatch. Train them on our phone system and train them on our pad system, and they'll be good to go. And which doesn't wouldn't even take me a week to train them on that.
And several of them have already been part-time dispatchers.
Yes, most of them
left because they left because they're making $15 an hour as a part-timer, so they get steady.
Well, where I was going with that was that is it possible that we need to hire just crisis.
So, one of the things that we did, and we've spent, or at least Brad has spent, the last 2.5 weeks of trying to figure out different ways of doing this. One of the things we did, the gentleman back here, Jerry, is from the Indiana State 911 Board. We brought him on board to help us just bash brains together and figure this out. We had some discussions at the emergency session to reach out to other centers and see if we could get their directors or some of their trainers, not just our surrounding counties, but other directors within the state, if they would be willing to come up and help. Downside to that, there's probably going to be a cost associated with that. We haven't moved forward on that because we don't want to set the county up to start spending money if we don't have the permission. Or
so these people would come here for the intent of to
and that's all they would do. And we want
there is no quick retraining.
That's my next question. But it just takes that long to train someone.
It does. I mean, this isn't like going to McDonald's or Mitchell's, and we show you a week how to make a taco or a hamburger. We deal with people's lives here, and I got to make sure that I'm comfortable with them being behind a console by themselves, where it's not a liability in this county. And we're not going to get a lawsuit because someone didn't get an ambulance or someone didn't get a police officer. It takes that long to make sure. I mean, I could probably squeeze it to 20 weeks, absolutely, but I want to make sure that they're ready to be behind a console by themselves and I don't have to worry.
So
it's
a long time. We're investing a lot of money.
And you still don't learn everything in that 24 weeks.
You do not. And the sad part is I'm training these people and they're leaving. They're leaving as soon as their training is done to go to another county to make more money. So I'm training them for another center.
Would you happen to have a survey or anything to see what surrounding counties are paying?
Yeah, I did. I have the pay rate scales from the entire state, from every 92 counties, and what they make. And
so surrounding counties right now, Cass County, when this was published, was their starting entry level was $22.14 an hour. However, in July, they received a $10,000 bonus.
It's a bonus?
No, it's a $10,000 increase in pay.
Mid-year.
Which puts it at how much?
I didn't break that down yet. It would take their base salary from $46,000 a year to $56,000 a year.
Their base salary is 36, or
it's 56. It was 46. It's now 56 for their entry level. Clinton County, right now, and I haven't heard if they received any bonuses or any increases. Clinton County is $22.24 an hour, or $46,259 a year. Howard County, they do not publish theirs. However, you can go into Gateway and find out their pay. I looked at all their full-timers, and the cheapest one that I saw that was there, from what I could figure, for a full year was $24.75 an hour, or $54,046.10 a year.
What's White County?
White County is $42,634. Tippecanoe County is $23.21 or $52,694. I'm sorry, that was West Lafayette. West Lafayette is $23.21 or $52,694, with Tippecanoe County $21.67 an hour, or $45,075.96 a year. With our dispatchers, we're starting out at $18.60. Top out on their, for lack of better terms, with longevity pay, or that bracketing that they do, they top out at $20 an hour after they've been here 16 years. I think it was 16 to 20 years, $20 and some odd cents an hour.
What is our rate?
Our rate starting is $18.60 an hour.
$18.
Starting.
I think part of the problem we're running into because all the agencies are fighting for staff, just like law enforcement. The local state of Indiana just got 40% of all state police agencies. And they're having to take officers from everybody because they can't find dispatch centers are doing the same thing. It's not just Indiana, it's all across the nation right now. But just the hurt, the smaller communities.
And the workforce just isn't there either. It's not, you know, that's part of it as well.
Some of that's true, but for the most part, those who don't want to work and want to sit on their rears out there are not the people we want to hire there anyway. We want to hire the top of the law.
Across the nation, it's not like people who are in the
nation. When I was working in jail, I did dispatch 9.5 years at this part of it. I enjoyed it.
Discussions we have on Friday because yes, these people are going to other municipalities, and one of the safest ones, obviously, they have a higher number of calls. So the grass might not necessarily be greener. However, even with that advanced number of calls, you still have another 2 or 3 dispatchers there to divide that workload. So I'm not certain.
She's currently only down one full-time position in that, in White.
If I remember, White County's got 3 on all time, don't they?
No.
They're down to 2?
She's well, 2 to 3.
She does have 2 to 3. 3 during their busy hours because they work the 3 to 11 shift. But normally it's just 2 at night and 2 during the day.
And we're still down just 1 on everything, right?
I have 1 dispatcher per rotation, which I'm supposed to have 2.
So they can
work with
the hour or
12?
We were 12. We're at hour 4 capacity. What were we or what do you feel comfortable having, like full time and part time?
Well, I have 2 dispatch positions, so 2 people per shift is absolutely necessary.
Okay.
So that would give me 8 full time dispatchers.
8 full?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I have last year, but 4 part-time.
I have currently 4 part-time guys.
Okay. And that is sufficient, or do you have more?
I mean, I'd like to have more to cover call-offs and
vacation.
Yes, vacation time, holidays.
Out of the 4 part-timers that he has right now, there's 1 that actually picks up several shifts. One works 1, maybe 2 shifts a month.
Brad, how many open shifts do you have this month?
I was able to get the schedule out on July 28th and went through and counted out my open shifts. I have 59 open shifts out of 124 when I'm fully staffed. it's nearly impossible. I can't fill every position, and I don't have part-time, and this is with the part-time on the schedule.
Did you say 39 hours on the...
When there's 31 days in the month, and I have four full-time dispatchers on rotation for a day, it's 124 total shifts for the month, and I have, you might as well say half of those shifts are open, because I don't have the dispatchers to fill those spots, and I can't fill them all myself. Which leaves us in a mess.
So we're down to one dispatcher per shift?
We are. I'm down to one dispatcher per shift. I do have two on the other night shift, but one of them is, she's pretty much out the door, because she's one less off yet. She's just waiting on her start date. So that will leave me one per shift before the other two.
Until you sit in dispatch, two's not enough. I mean, you don't really understand when you have a crash, a bad crash. The dispatcher is taking care of fire, ambulance, police, if there were a helicopter. I mean, it is swamped. Don't get me wrong, there are times where it's slow, but when something bad happens, it's bad.
Two positions, this isn't enough sometimes. I could, a third one would be great, so I could step in if it was busy, or I could have another staff member come in if it was busy.
But one is better, yeah.
Yeah, it does.
So you still gotta take the regular phone calls and your other 911 calls.
Yeah.
Then you got every Tom, Dick, and Harry wanting to talk on the radio at the same time.
And getting angry if they're not getting answered.
Exactly.
So even if you hire 10 people in the next 2 weeks, it's gonna be...
Six or seven months.
It's gonna be 6 or 7 months before I can meet someone. Yes.
So he's the new airborne president?
Yeah, he's the president.
Jeff Shannon's my...
What happens when this happens? What do you do?
You create a, I'm executive director of the 911. So I've spent 34 years, started out as a dispatcher, directorship, so I've gone through this partly before. Right now, it's kind of unique, because it's happening more widespread. And a lot of it now is being driven, well, one by the money, and two, the workforce. A lot of them, it was kick the pay issue down the road, down the road, down the road, and then they find out, oh gosh, I'm gonna bend it, is to raise it. Well, then when they raise it, since they kicked it down the road so far, that raise is very significant when they have to make that adjustment, rather than being a graduate every year. And even some of the bigger counties that historically paid more are now finding that they're kind of paying less than even some of the smaller counties, but they're competing against the smaller counties for that pay rate. So, what you're going through, part of it's not unique. I think the severity of it is more than a lot of them we've seen. Usually, you might be talking 25-30% down, but down as low as, you know, as your county is right now. That's going to be a lot, especially when you take into account the training and so forth. I think last Friday we were talking, when the state police dispatchers start making more than the local dispatchers, that is bizarre. Because much like the troopers weren't making that much, now their dispatchers are starting off at $47,000 a year, and the counties are now losing dispatchers to the state police, which usually we were recruiting from the state police because they had the training, we could bring them in, we had more money. Those are some of the things, you know, that's what we're seeing all over the place. As far as the funding goes, I know when I was in Monroe County for 31 years, when we first went to the consolidated part of it, we had city employees, we had county employees, and the pay was a problem there because we wanted the county employees brought up to the pay of the city employees, which included whenever the city got a raise, the county would get a raise. Well, the first year we got there, the county says, no, we're not getting raises because we're not giving anybody raises. We had the MOU in place. Literally, what we were doing is we had our 1222 fund, we weren't touching it for a really long time, so there was a huge excess there. We were actually, the raises were coming out of that. So they had the regular pay coming out of one fund, and then they were pulling out whatever the yearly raise was, how that 1222
that was some of the creative stuff as far as doing that funding. Even now with the public safety lit or telecommunication lit, you know, that was one of the things that was put in place to kind of help fund the dispatch centers. In some counties, you know, they went with the public safety lit and they looked at it and they go, okay, we can fund the PSAP center, but it's just going to be enough to fund their budget because they use the rest of that money to go back to their general fund, but they're still in the same boat they were again. When you start talking about turnover, the expense that a lot of people don't think about is, yes, you train somebody and they go to another center, but what's it costing you to train that individual? It's not just the salary that you're paying him or the benefits you're paying him. It's the time of your trainers that are involved. It's the time, you know, the time of your, basically your auditor, everybody in the county, because they all have to touch something that deals with that employee. Timesheets, whoever deals with insurance, HR. And that's a significant cost as well when you're going through those turnovers.
Brad, your trainers don't get nothing special to stand in the way for being a trainer.
They get no compensation for training. No.
Is that why they're using the trainer? Are they just tired of training because they've done so many left? Or is it a personnel issue?
I think it's a personnel issue.
I don't understand how whoever it is can refuse.
After I took it out of my budget line to pay for her training, I don't understand it myself.
Well,
is
so
you
force it on
them
and
they leave. It is not. But she came to me to become a trainer.
He has been very, in our office, he's been great. We have nobody calling in about complaints about 911. We do not have paperwork that's not in. We do not have that paperwork that's on time. His claims are always on time. His payroll is always on time. When you hire somebody, we have it probably before.
When I worked here in 2020 to train either, but I went back for training because I was asked by my director to train.
And I know, but in this
person agreed
age,
to go to the training
in
to
this
become
day
a trainer.
Age, if it's not in the job description, don't plan on people doing it.
Well, then how am I going to train
the
employees?
Job description down to the very last line in every job description here.
Are they giving you such a sign?
Yes, that is exactly what it says.
Duties assigned by the department.
She agreed to go to the training.
So
it's not like this was a forced thing.
She went to the training, she owes him. The only reason I'm saying that is that it might be in the best interest to put that as a job description. And then there would be no qualms and you will train it in the job description.
If I can add something to that CTO, again, the turnover of the CTO, that's another thing. This dispatch center dealing with because of their CTO and somebody across the line says, hey, we're hiring and I'll give you an extra bonus for being a CTO. Not only are you training a new person potentially as a dispatcher, but somewhere down the road, you're going to be paying again for them to go to the CTO training. Right now, probably the most, I'm not saying probably, right from my head, because they were doing another one. The most requested class that we are dealing with right now in the state of Indiana is that CTO class.
That's why I kind of asked if it would be beneficial to actually have the job description that you're just a trainer.
I don't understand what the job description would make a difference when it's duties
well,
that's
it's
assigned
more
in
pay,
the current job description.
It's more pay is what it is. It's not really.
It's never been more pay here.
Pay.
I know that. I'm saying would it be beneficial to have that job description?
Yes. I think more people would be willing to train.
Because when you're sitting there, you're still doing your regular job, and you have this person sitting next to you that's tethered to you, listening. They're trying to ask you questions why you're doing this, while you're still trying to concentrate.
Let me start over. So you have a position that they are a trainer. It would be more money, and that is their job. And then when you say you have weeks that you're not training, then they're a dispatcher. Does that make sense?
It does.
So, I mean, we don't hire trainers.
You're just adding a trainer.
You're adding trainer to their current job description.
I would make it a position. It seems like it's a vicious position, but it's really needed now. It might take a position of a dispatcher that you already have positioned, but maybe, because that's kind of what he just said, there, if you're a CTO, is that what you call it?
Yeah.
So maybe that's a position that kind of, maybe we should look at doing.
But wouldn't that be a payroll nightmare?
Absolutely.
No, because they're gonna hire you, they're gonna get paid to be trained.
Well, then.
They're not gonna be trained, we don't know if they're trained or not, if I'm listening to you correctly. Plus, you can't have two job descriptions.
There's two job descriptions.
There would be, because they're still gonna have to function as a dispatcher in my center.
In their job description, they're gonna hire in as a trainer.
And a dispatcher.
If they are not training, they will dispatch.
But I don't hire trainers in as a trainer unless they've been a dispatcher for at least a year. There's a requirement. They have to have some type of dispatch experience.
Looking at it from a law enforcement perspective, there's several roles that are training instructors on the law enforcement side. A lot of agencies will look at like a $500 or $1,000 a year bump just for being a training officer.
That would be.
Maybe that's what.
Do you get a bonus, do you get more money for being a trainer?
Our guys do.
Your guys.
But I think the city of Delphi started that at $500 per special year.
$500.
Yeah, so maybe that's something that you could tack on once they became an instructor, they would get that extra $500 a year as long as they held that instructor certification.
I was just thinking that there was already people out there with the education to be your trainer.
Oh, absolutely, if I could hire someone in who was a seasoned dispatcher and I trusted them to train, absolutely.
You add a dollar or two more onto that position, they come in and they're your trainer.
Yes.
And your dispatcher.
My next thing to that though, so if he needs eight full-time, are you gonna have another spot just specifically for the trainer, so that's technically nine spots?
No, I don't know, I'm just throwing, I'm just brainstorming, but.
Because he's still gonna need the eight full-timers that are still dispatching. So if you can create a spot for just the trainer, that'd be a nine spot already, so that'd be another full.
And I don't know, but I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, how many times in the last 5 years have you been a full staff?
Zero, I haven't been here for 5 years, but when I was here from 17 to 20, we were fully staffed.
So that trainer would be dispatching also.
And that was me when I worked here.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, your complicator, it just really, if you hire people as a dispatcher, and again, I'll talk from the law enforcement side, we hire deputies, and then as they progress in their career, after 3 years, they can become a field training officer to train other guys when they come in.
Do they get more money?
Not here, everywhere else, yes, but.
It's a money game nowadays.
I was gonna, you tell me about it, but.
Yes.
But that is part of their, that is part of just, part of the job, it's not a description, but they're accepting that when I send them to that field training schooling. They accept that role, and that's where I'm at with her right now. She accepted the role, he didn't force her to go to training.
I did not.
Become a trainer.
She specifically asked.
She's just now backing out of it. And yeah, if you bumped in $500 for these specialties that all, because everybody's, we're all doing it, it's, and everywhere else to pay for it, but not Carroll County. But if you bumped in, okay, you're a trainer, you're a certified training officer now, and you get $500 extra a year, I don't know why you have to change your job description per se and keep it separate. You're compensating them for being a training officer.
I was just thinking on trying to highlight to get people to look at Carroll County and say, look, you hire me as a trainer, you hire me this much. And I was just thinking of different avenues that has already been done.
A lot of the surrounding agencies, when they're doing the hiring, they'll put in there, this is our base salary, but if you're a certified trainer, you get an additional 500, or you get an additional 1,000. When like law enforcement guys, if you're an FTO, it's 500 bucks. If you're a firearms guy, it's another 500. If you're an emergency vehicle operation instructor, it's another 500.
What if you hired a trainer position and it was $4,000 a year?
Possibly.
I mean, I'm not talking $500.
I'm talking
a substantial amount to get them to apply to be a trainer, and they will stay.
It depends on what the base pay is.
Exactly.
It would all depend on the base pay.
And a lot of them will fill training officers. You want somebody to go care about the job. I mean, our deputy, they can fill training officers, my work, or they work.
I'm not talking about.
It's the same way with dispatch. Brad right here is one hell of an example. He stepped up, he did the job. He had issues, he had to leave. When this position came open, this is the first thing that came to me. I'm like, this guy right here will turn our 911 center around and he's doing it. But we just don't have the people to do it.
You gotta
have that person who cares about the job.
But you also have people there that aren't working.
You got people in there just for a day.
Yeah, and they don't want to stay. They don't, they weren't used to these rules and regulations a couple years ago. So we all know that.
It's tough, though, to expect people to come in and be loyal to Carroll County, loyal to everybody here, and from a pay standpoint, we're not loyal to them.
Right.
That's a problem. Now, I'm looking at this, the $500 or $1,000 training minutia. That's not the answer. I'm looking at cash, and I've been filling the numbers here while listening to you all. If Cass County can pay $28 an hour, and we're paying $18, I think that just jumps out at me what the problem is. And Clinton County paying over $22 an hour, Howard $24.75, Lights over $21, Tippecanoe's almost $22, and West Lafayette's a little over $22. That's still like $4 an hour less you get here than you get there. We need to move to be one of the better payers here, and we'll fill the ranks. We'll get the professional people. We will have loyalty. But we've got to do it on our side, too.
Mike and I, at the meeting Friday, were talking about the two separate accounts, the 1172. That piece out as well as the 1222 statewide 911. I think it was mentioned by the state director that a lot of times that 1222 statewide 911, they found ways to pay, utilize that for some of the balances in the 1222 fund to pay. That may be a way to get, because I say that we're on the heels of budget preparation for 24 now. But that may be a way, because we figure that we have about $85,000, maybe $90,000 left over in that statewide 911 account by the end of the year. And if things continue the same way. So that may be the solution. So that in a way to get us through prior to negotiations for 24. Just an idea.
I have a question. So say we were saying we were $4 or $5 lower than our loans. So say we get that to these dispatchers, which possibly is represented. Do you realize that that is where your police officer would also be?
No,
and what do you think your police
$2,600.
Even with the 2.7% increases we've done in the past couple of years, we're still at like $80.
Nice.
I mean, it gets promoted, it started, so how do things look?
Well, I think that's what Cass County realized, when they decided to make years, when they did their big bumps for jail, sheriff's deputies and dispatch, and they promised.
He thought a short-term plan helped now, and then he said it's an emergency, and you guys need to really work on that. I'm just pouring them on, he said to me.
Did he describe how short-term, like, when that would make, because I think Brad's ready for people now, and more people are leaving, so.
He's gonna get the information to me in the next Wednesday, and he suggested that you guys can meet in on the 10th, and he would be available by then. So, I'm just giving you what he told us, told me.
I'd always have the information before we go over the numbers.
You don't have my own money. As we have in the works.
The one that dispatch, dispatch is on the verge of not having enough to cover the insurance now.
So if that young lady is leaving, she got her raise tomorrow, would she stay in Carroll County?
I have no idea if she would stay or not.
I think that.
There's actually one.
That one, if she's.
She's going home.
She's going home, her husband is not over there.
It's closer to home.
She's getting a bigger pay, closer to home. If I ever understood somebody doing what they're doing, it's this one.
It's not gonna sound a problem, you need to be right, you're not gonna make very much money with dispatch.
And that's why we need, that's why we need to pump the part-time stuff up.
To get some over.
So if we just change the part-time right now, try to lure some of those others to come over and work with us part-time.
Just temporary.
Temporary.
Just temporary time thing, just because.
We used to get some of the Cass County too, that would come down and work with us on days off.
Well, as we see the rise, probably not, it's not really gonna change the end of the change.
Well, yeah, I would recommend right now, take the part-time salary and make it a full-time dispatcher, but if you're doing the same job.
I don't think that's gonna bring things here.
But it's a start.
It's not gonna bring.
But you can't bring your part-time, because then it's gonna make more money right now than your full-time, then that's gonna make business.
What do you suggest?
Do what?
What do you suggest with that?
I don't know, $25-$30 an hour to make these people wanna come on a temporary basis down here, and you're 1,000% right, that's gonna tick off our current dispatcher. So the ones that are being loyal and sticking it out, you temporarily bump them too. And then you're right, it's gonna piss off my jailers. You know, it's gonna trickle, but there's a crisis. I mean, I'm gonna sit here all day arguing for my guys, but there's a crisis.
You can't do that.
Can't do what?
You can't
like that
and not your full-time people.
No, I know, that's what I said.
Maybe just, that's why we're asking.
But if you're only gonna have two people that are sticking it out here in a couple weeks anyway.
Two full-time dispatchers.
To temporary full-time, then it's one of the trainees. Because we're about to only have two dispatchers in Brad.
I really do not feel comfortable making any decisions today without going through Norm and that, because I can see a place that we give at least two people. I have to know them now. I just don't know about that.
And it's a lot. I'm just telling you what in my mind, what I think it's gonna take to bring a seasoned dispatcher back here to get us through this extremely rough emergency time. That's the ask for a number, and that's why.
I've never seen anything go backwards on day wage.
$25 to $30 an hour would go backwards.
No, that would go way forward, and then you said it temporary. But I've never seen her.
We just.
Well, that's the problem. That's not what you guys are doing now. That's the thing. You guys control it now. So if you bring that part-time pay up, even if you leave the full-time pay, give them incentive to stay at the end of the year, give them a bonus for sticking out the year and match it out. So that way it solves the problem now, because eventually what's going to happen in 2 to 3 weeks, no one's going to be answering the problem. That's the biggest problem. So if you park, if you do the part-time thing now, stand up, and people hear that according to drain here, that solves a temporary solution.
Do you have a number in mind for part-time and full-time?
Do I have a number in mind? I agree with Tony. We're gonna have to boost this pay up to get some seasoned dispatchers here. I'm still in a mess regardless.
Sure.
But if I can get people here who know how to do this job, and I gotta just train them for a few days on our console or on our CAD system and our phone system, I will have people here from different centers who actually can do this job. There are 3 full-time people leaving this center very soon. And I'm going to have 2 dispatchers and myself, and I can't work every day. I will not.
I still haven't answered the phone and radio, but I can't do the CAD.
I can't sit behind the console for a full rotation and be expected to do this job also.
Can we raise part-time and non-full-time?
Yes.
I don't know how to.
We're looking to raise full-time or full-time.
You're gonna have this one to maybe to pick up a public or one of the reasons.
The public safety. So even Flora, they bumped their part-time for a guy to above what their full-time guys are making because they didn't have the benefits that they were having to pay and things like that. I mean, I don't know why you can't bump it up.
Yeah,
other than you're right, people are going to be mad. I'm not.
They'll be making more than the police. I'm just looking at it.
But the problem is, nobody will be there to dispatch a police officer.
They will not be. I think right now I think our deputies, Flora, and them guys want good people in our dispatch. I think the pay will come later for them, but for them, it's their safety. They're out on that call. There's nobody in that center to say, hey, I need backup. The only ones going to hear it would be dispatch and maybe if somebody had the radio on that call. And I would want to be sitting in there for that one.
There's a couple officers here, aren't there?
There's a couple of
things. How do you feel about that?
I'm okay. Firstly, yeah. Speaking out, I'm the next senior outside of Tony and I don't have a single problem with it right now because I know what it's a bind that we're in and I know there's a solution coming. So I don't have an issue with it right now.
That's not whatever.
I've been here for almost 14 years full time, and that's not including the jail time that I've been here before. I got laid off in
2008.
How many hours?
Dispatchers are lifeline.
Yeah.
Pretty
so
much,
yes. Pay them. If they're going to help me get home safe with my family,
absolutely.
Pay them.
Well, I'd like to throw in right now that from my vantage point, Brad has brought us a whole new level of professionalism than what we've had in the last 2 or 3 people at the head of 911. And when he comes into us and talks to us, he knows what he's talking about and we appreciate it. I think that it's always, I don't know, I've bought out probably 25 businesses in my lifetime, and it never works for me to keep the old crew and go ahead. I don't know, Ethan, like, out of your 70 employees you have, how many are there from the old owners?
Yeah.
Not a one.
Yeah.
You've got to own your spot, you've got to own your way of doing it, you've got to own your management style, and you can't do it if everybody in there is sitting there saying, oh, but we used to do it like this, you know. This is the way I want to stick to doing it how we used to. No, you can't do that. So to me, we're looking at, I think there's a good side to this too, that we're going to, if we can clean house, that doesn't mean it has to be everybody, because if you've got 1 or 2 that are really good ones and you want to keep them, good. But
so the house is clean.
Bringing in new people is a good idea. And I think we're going to have to look at $28 to $30 an hour for everybody in there to make this thing work. And I know that's going to hurt, but we don't have a choice.
I'd like to said that they would have the information to us by next week, and they could be here on the 10th. I come. I would really like to go over the information and then we can make a decision. It's 7 days.
So meet on the 10th again?
If that's in here.
when I lose these three employees very soon, who's going to come in and help me dispatch these calls out? I don't have anyone. Am I expected to work that as the working director, work every shift, and make sure that these guys are safe? Because officer safety is my number one priority here.
That other dispatchers from other centers contacted me and said, we bump the pay, sign me up for the program.
So I think that answers the question, right? I mean, if we can do our homework between now and next week, because I'll be honest, like, I came into this meeting with not a lot of traction on this issue. So if we can be better educated between now and next week, and then make an informed decision next week.
No, and I agree with
right?
that. I totally agree with that. I'm not saying that I don't, but I'm just saying, I'm in a staffing nightmare right now, yeah. And I don't have the people, and I'm losing people, and I'm not expecting you to give me an answer tonight. That was not my intention. I don't know.
I will call Lori tomorrow, okay? And she told me she could do it earlier. I mean, you obviously know I told you I could have reached out.
Absolutely. They heard the grumbling, and they reached out to us, but they're just not going to come back and do it at $15 an hour.
No. I think I know where you're talking about. Well, there's a damn good district. I would love to have them full-time in our staff. Because I know our officers and our part of the personnel on the EMS would be a good answer.
And please don't. I don't mean any disrespect, but at all, and what I've said. But my number one priority here is every single person out here on the street. If I didn't care about this county, I would have never came back here. I don't live here. And I don't even know what to say without getting all emotional about it, but these guys are my number one priority. All the first responders, EMS, fire, law enforcement. I just want to make sure there's somebody there to dispatch for them, so they're not left out there by themselves.
So I'll ask you, if you please come to the engineer, I don't think any of us are considering say that we're not going to do something.
Right.
We just don't know what we're going to do. We just need a little more guidance. So if you know these people, then you previously want to come back.
One of the points that we were talking about Friday, and I asked Brad if it was societal, because he said he had all these job applications and all, you know, he had one and he had dropped the fire. He made a comment. He said, you know, some of them never even showed up after I called them for him. And I sure hope, as we have spoken already, I sure hope that we get it. We all have this grandiose idea of getting all these qualified and, you know, top tier people in here. We may not be able to. No, I mean, the facts are facts, but
that's one of the reasons why I don't want to do a lot, is because I'm not so sure that raising a part time right now isn't the solution. I mean, it's part time and full time right now.
Well, I concur. I definitely agree with that. But we've got, you know, everyone we have on the staff the best way we can until we, you know, I mean, it's a family on a day to day, I know, but until we get some people hired.
We're also civil nature, we need to be aware of the
We have Scott. He said that we have the money in our statewide number one. Why wouldn't we make the motion today to make one with the four of us here? I mean, obviously, I've got a broad blanket for this, but you've got a situation that is dire to us today. Not, I mean, I know it's a week away we're talking about, but still, if we have the money available on fund, why wouldn't we use it today?
And just to throw out, because I'm not disagreeing with you, but he has 59 open shifts for the month of August.
I can finish what I was talking about with Lori. I asked her if she could get it to me by Monday. She said definitely we'll get something to you tomorrow morning. Because I said we're down to two dispatchers.
And
we'll have it tomorrow. And I can get it to the council tomorrow.
I think if it's going to be that soon, I mean, we're talking just a handful.
was a part-time waiter in that?
I maxed them out at 15.
And I agree with you, I love that this is the day, guys. How are you gonna justify $3, $5? Who gets the part-time full-time without some kind of direction?
Right, well, we're getting, we have to be above everybody else, so, because if we come in at 20, well, Clinton County still pays 22, so they're still gonna go to Clinton County, but if we come back at 26, why wouldn't they come to $4? I just, if they're already living here and driving to Clinton County, but.
The only thing at least bump them up part-time to up to $18 an hour, that might be a little bit of the same to sign up for this one, and maybe more later.
It's gonna show that you're doing something.
It shows that you're trying, make it up to 18, but not if you get permission, to show them that you're doing something. Then you guys decide what you need to do.
We got another time Monday, what's gonna happen tomorrow, and then I'll send them out to you. If they will go out by email, so you guys have to get it off your email.
And I don't know that way, it's kind of clear what I was saying when I was talking 25 to 30, that's a temporary thing to get us through this. Why are you shaking your head?
Temporary though, I mean, it's not gonna be temporary, because this is how we have to go in the future.
I agree, I agree, but.
That's all the way back to the page. If you're only gonna do it because you're hurt, then you're gonna go back to and take away.
But again, let's just say you guys agree for the 30, let's just say 30, and White County's making 22. They're gonna come here on their days off. My wife, she's a nurse, when they set out incentive pay, we'll pay you double, she's gone to work. I mean, if that's the kind of, I think, the kind of situation we're in, and we don't always offer that incentive pay.
I guess I'm gonna look at it full time. I want people to come here and work a stay.
I do too.
So I wanna pay them.
I do.
I agree, my mindset, I'm 1,000% for it. Every emergency personnel in this county need a bump, we're really behind.
I agree.
But I'm just thinking about the short-term crisis that we're in. That's all my head is at, is we're in a crisis right now. And does Monday make a huge difference? I don't think so. Do I think 18's gonna show anybody anything? Nope, they're not coming in for $18. So I don't know that if you do that today, it's not gonna, but just, again, somehow set up as an incentive that for the time being, because when we get our staff trained, when we get our full staff trained, we don't need those people to come down here for $25 or $30 an hour. It's a temporary fix to a big problem. And it's cheaper than even if someone would pay us, it's cheaper than $300,000 that we'd have to pay some other county to remotely dispatch us.
I mean, if we really read the plan, say, and then look, I would like for us to maybe meet a little more when we begin, so we can go over the numbers and have a little bit of a plan now, and fix the part-time and the full-time. Because I think it's both a big problem.
Yeah, because it's a huge problem in general across the board, and there's gonna be people upset. But I'm here today, like as the president of the 911 board, and I'm worried about it.
Yes. I was in the Friday meeting when they were talking about that. The other potential for saying, okay, we're going to give part-timers, you know, if it's temporary, just fill it to get us through this rough spot and get everybody on board. The other potential out of that, though, is even if the pay isn't as much as what they're making where they currently are, if they like the work environment, some of those same people that you pull in, they very well say, oh, I want to go for that. So you've got to look at it in comes in. And that's one of the things I've kind of, in hiring people, just when you think you've got hiring people figured out and how they think, they change. And that was one of the things, somebody could come in here very well and just say, oh, well, it's part-time, you're going to be dedicated. But you may get that gem of that part-timer that says, you know, I want to come in full-time. Guess what you also just did, with the exception of the CAD, maybe some of the nuances of the center, you've got somebody who's already trained. So you're not seeking extra money from that way. It may not always work out that I say one more thing? This meeting and the way you have been talking through this is incredible. Kudos to you. I'm serious. You know, the whole thing is throwing ideas out there, trying to come up with something. Just, you know, everybody's thinking about it from every single angle. And I'm going to give you guys kudos for that, because it's not always the case with the local governments when we talk about these things.
So you want time to just to really know what you're doing when you come to the next thing?
I would like to ask our president if he could give me Monday, Tuesday, or Monday.
Oh, I have an idea. Yeah. It's too late to advertise another executive session. All right, not an executive session, a joint meeting. But you do have a joint meeting at 1 o'clock about ARPA. Are you guys ready to do ARPA? I think we could push that back and do, I know it's already been advertised that way, but you can also add, because there's add, but agendas are always subject to change.
You could also re, what's the word?
Re-convene?
No. Just continue this meeting on. You don't have to adjourn it. And you just say when you're going to meet the next time. Whichever way that works. Yeah.
Thank you all.